Hello everyone, welcome to the webinar out here. We are at the Exchange for Media webinar. We're going to be talking about how driving performance in mobile marketing essentially, and we have a beautiful panel out here coming from brands as well as platform solutions, and I would let the panel introduce themselves. I think we can start off with Amit because you're on the top left of my screen, so I think we could just go that way. Amit comes from Cisco, and I would let Amit introduce himself.
Well, thank you so much, guys. My name is Amit. As Mitesh mentioned, I represent Cisco, a name which is very well known in the space of LED lighting in the entire country. It belongs to FMEG space, so it's not CG and CD. It is something which is very different. It is EG, fast moving electrical goods. And as we speak, it is a very diversified brand right now. Obviously, right from your LED lights to your grooming appliances, wires and cables, fans, switches, mobile accessories, and the latest is smart home devices. So I think this entire diversification has made the entire journey as a marketeer very, very interesting for me. So there's a lot to talk about as to how we have dealt with pre and post COVID. I think that is something that you're all looking forward for. So
Perfect. All right. Thank you, Amit. I think Ankit, you're next on my screen, so I'll just take it that way. So if you could introduce yourself.
Sure, Mitesh. Hi, everyone. I hope I'm audible. I'm Ankit Prasad, founder and CEO at Bobble AI. We have built world's largest and first conversation media platform. And as the name suggests, we are enriching everyday conversation on smartphones with our expressive and fun technologies. These ranging from keyboard technology to conversational content like stickers, GIFs, emojis. We have more than 30 million users who are using our product. Some of our well-known products are Bobble Indic keyboard and Mint keyboard. Mint is in fact the default keyboard of all the Xiaomi phones in India and Indonesia. So please do check out our products and let me know how you feel about them. So we are primarily into the conversation media space.
Perfect. All right. I think next to the gentleman from Future Group, Pawan, if you could introduce yourselves, though all of us know you very well, but for the viewers, I think it would be great if you could introduce yourself.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. This is Pawan Sarda from Future Group. I'm the CM at Future Group. Thank you.
Perfect. I think that's short and sweet. We'll move to Arjun, if you could introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. My name is Arjun. I lead the ads monetization for Spotify in India. For those who don't know, Spotify is the world's largest audio platform across music and podcasts. And we've been in India for about 18 months. So early days and fun times. Looking forward to the conversation. Thanks.
Great. Darshna, if you could introduce yourself now.
Thanks, Mitesh. And hi, everybody. And I'm happy to be here at E4M webinar. And I'm Darshna Shah, part of Aditya Birla Capital, Aditya Birla Health Insurance. And yeah, looking forward.
Thank you. Last, Manuel, I think we're on to you now. If you could introduce yourself.
Yeah, sure. Good evening, everyone. My name is Manuel, and I represent a company called CleverTap, which is positioned to solve user retention problem across apps and websites.
Great. Perfect. So I think as we, we had discussed, and the topic itself is how do you drive more performance on the mobile marketing, domain, in the domain or on the platform and other things. And we all had separate conversations where we tried to understand more in terms of what you're all doing, right? But if we start off somewhere, right, it's a very simple point where we want to start off by understanding is, let's say why mobile should be a prominent part of the marketing strat in the current COVID, going ahead in the future, obviously from here. And how can it be used effectively to tell a brand story, right? Because three of you come from the brand side, and there is a big emphasis on all three brands that we have here on the storytelling, right? And I mean, while the question might seem something where we want to start off, but the key pieces I want to put through is something has shifted in COVID, So one thing is I'm actually at my parents' home. I'm operating out of my parents' home, which I've never done in my whole working life. This is the first time ever. Right. And what I heard my parents recently speak about is like, no, we don't have a timeline. We don't have a schedule anymore. You're just busy on your phone whole day. And that is how it is going. Right. So what you see somewhere is that there are lines are blurred. Consumers reach out to the phone for each and everything. especially in the COVID scenario where there is not a lot more to do. Also, somewhere there is that always on mentality which has stepped in, right? You're completely always on, accessible, communicating, seeing. I mean, I'm sure Bobble could prove that for us in terms of the statistics that they've seen, essentially, right? So this is where, so why is it important and how could you use it back into weaving the brand story across? I think if we could first, you know, take it with you, Pawan and Darshna, if you could bring out and Amit from the brand's end, you know, how do you guys see it? And then we could obviously move towards the platform. Pawan, if you could, you know, take this.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe ladies first. So
yeah, I think we should do that. My bad. Darshna, I think we'll let you go first then.
Always.
No, it's fine. It's fine. Yeah.
No, please go ahead, Darshna. Start off with you.
Okay, so thanks. So yeah, so Mitesh, let me, so in my category, specifically health insurance,
yes,
it's a category which is what you buy and forget. It's an intangible benefit you buy and you don't want to use it because obviously you don't want to be in the hospital. So what we have seen, the difference, it's not an engaging category. What we have definitely tried and what we want to do is we want to talk health first and health insurance. We just don't want to be a plain funding category, and that's how we've launched since past 4 years. That's what we do. Now, coming to the consumer behavior change, and specifically in COVID, we've seen that the screens, and thanks to the penetration of smartphones and internet in India, and you know, with I think 50 crore houses, that, and thanks to all of that, so the screens have changed from a television big screen to everybody coming to this small screen in my own hand. So with that, content has changed. It used to be when we were young and, you know, if you were at your parents' house, you would have one television and all of us are watching that thing together. To today's world where the screen has changed, smartphones have penetrated, you have your own phone, that small screen in your hand. And what data tells us from pre-COVID to post-COVID now, you see at least 25-30% increase in the time spent on that screen. Plus, it is now my own content. And this, I have, so we did a recent study and we also seen the way housewives in India, the homemakers, so it's no more, you know, everybody glued to that screen because now today everybody's at home. So people, some people are watching cricket, some people, so everybody have their me time, my content, what I want to do, what I want to see. So content is becoming the king, the hero, and people are personalizing their content and use it in that space. I mean, I think it's very interesting times for marketeers because now we have to plan for this kind of content and for that screen in the hand and to engage. So for a category like mine, for, you know, health insurance, where I said we speak health first, what we did is we realized that people at home don't know what to do. They really, there was a lot of anxiety during COVID, the initial months, a lot of stress, frustration. That's what we said, health first. So we created an entire Facebook Live series called Health From Home. And this is what you could every day log into your Facebook in the morning to evening. And it was physical fitness, mental fitness. We were calling doctors. A lot of, so answering your questions is all live, and nutritional fitness. So all these wellness series that I was doing for 4 months every day from 8:30 to 7 o'clock in the evening, getting different kind of consumers coming on the platform talking. And that's how you, so you're not just talking health insurance, you're talking health, you're talking mental wellness, which is such a key. So I think that's how we started engaging. That's why we've seen people coming to us, talking to us, asking their questions openly. We've created a mental health line and many such things. So health from home become a big initiative for us. It's also part of Facebook Hall of Fame. So, and this is what the screen has done. If you can get your content right, you will get them to engage with you. Otherwise, you will lose them. But this is where people are. You don't know where else to go. There is no cinema. There is no shopping. Everything is on this phone and it is all personalized to my taste. So today in my house, my son will have his own content. My, you know, husband will have his own and I will have my own. That's how it has become so diversified. And that's why as marketeers, we have to become so more relevant and meaningful when you're driving content on that screen. So
it makes sense. So I think, you know, before we move on, Darshna, one thing I wanted to ask from you is because of the kind of category that you are in, and we were talking about this before the start of the discussion itself. Have you seen the shift of the millennial audience from I want to know to I want to buy, that micro moment into the health insurance category? Because suddenly the product has now become more important even in the consumer mind at the end of the day.
Absolutely. We've seen that. So I was saying this is a, you know, when, because I come from retail and that's how, you know, I know Pawan. And I used to always say that, oh my God, health insurance. Nobody wakes up to say that, you know, wait, today I want to go and buy a health insurance. So given to that life, to suddenly this entire COVID as a backdrop and the fear, anxiety that it has brought into people and also the cost of medical care, the COVID care, if you're hospitalized and the kind of cost and, you know, money that it's wiping away savings and on the other side, people are losing jobs. So putting all of that, you know, together and financial protection. So we've definitely, so millennials specifically, since you asked me, the whole attitude that I want to experience things and vis-a-vis not want to own, that attitude is now changing. They are realizing that they, because if they are not careful, then who's going to take care of them? They have to go and buy their parents' savings. So that entire attitude of, I don't want to own a car and I don't want to own a house, to, you know, the other day I was hearing from one of my friend who is part of the residential. People are today now looking at having their own places because you want to be safe. You want your security.
True.
And that's why health and insurance conversation has become a, you know, it's a pull category suddenly from a push. People are waking up to saying that, am I adequately covered? Or what next? You know, so I think that's really changed for the category. This is, so I think these are exciting times, yes. I don't know whether it is just a pent-up moment because now people are fighting to go back to normalcy. And will this change? I don't know. But yes, for the past 6 months, we've seen that change. Including millennials who would believe that, you know, I don't need it, to now I want it, I have to have it.
Well, I'm glad few people can say it's a golden time. So I could see Pawan smiling when you said that, right? So I think Pawan, we'll move on to you right now. Coming to you, Future Group, which is so diversified, so omni-channel, I think, more than anything else, right? And we've known you also coming in, putting in initiatives that really drove things. In fact, from your past of Tata Homes and other things, there have been a lot of specific intent towards digital that you've done, right? But if we dissect digital, we get a bit more into mobile, right? Because which is becoming a large part of digital right now at this point of time. So how or why is it prominent for you in the COVID time? So going ahead in the future also, that mobile strategy per se, saying, you know, this has to take some kind of a precedence or has to have some kind of importance in our overall strategy, digital marketing strategy.
Great. So
how do you look at that?
Yeah, thanks, Mitesh. Firstly, I feel that, you know, it's all about mobile. I think digital is just, you know, one of the big part. But finally, it's about mobile because I think that's where the consumption is happening and that's where exactly penetration is. That's exactly, I think, Darshana was talking about. I think that's number one. I'm going to address this in two parts. One is from a consumer side. We all know it. We all know it, what happened pre-COVID and now. Obviously, the penetration, the content usage, the time spent, I think everything has gone up, like dramatically it's gone up. But I personally feel that it was valid even before COVID, just as a platform, as a device, as a marketeer's tool. I think it was valid even then. But now I think that there is a sense of acceptance sort of which has come among the marketeers. More than anything else, I see that our boardroom, if you ask me, you know, they have kind of gone warmed up to the idea of digital. I don't think Samir, Darshana or me, we would have any doubt about, you know, the medium. I think the doubts were at the boardroom, right? And I think that's what something which has been sort of kind of, you know, addressed in that sense. And that's why when Darshana says we are here to have a good time now, yes, of course, because, you know, that was a big struggle because, you know, when you come from a sort of a background and the acceptance of, you know, doing something on mobile, we've battled our own journey, you know, within the boardroom and so on, right? That maybe I think we don't need to as much. I think that's a big change, which I can see it. I think if you, you know, if I talk on behalf of Future Group, and honestly, I think mobile has really helped us to generate business in last 6 to 8 months. I mean, that's the only source of device to actually engage and communicate with our audience. You know, so much so that like we are launching Sara Ali Khan this weekend through a mobile campaign. I mean, Future Group would have never ever thought to do something like that, right? But yeah, I mean, that's the medium where people are. That's the medium where people are consuming, spending time. So why not? I think that's a big change which has sort of happened. And when it comes to mobile, I also feel that as a marketeer, you know, I'm very particular about this one aspect of 3 seconds. I mean, that's all it you know, a consumer, you know, they have it for you. You have to ensure that, you know, how you create stories within 3 seconds, right? I mean, that's where you get effectiveness, right? I mean, there's a bit of a shift which you need to do when you think of a, let's say, a traditional marketing to a mobile marketing. This 3 second shift is a hugely important aspect. I mean, anything a consumer, whether it's a long form content, small form content, it doesn't matter. The decision of consumer to spend time with you is just, he takes that decision within 3 seconds, right? Yeah. I mean, I'm a big believer of that. You know, that's what we are pushing in, and that's how we create all kind of campaign. But I personally feel that, you know, mobile marketing, digital marketing is it's mainstream. I mean, there shouldn't be any debate or discussion. I mean, that's how I see it.
Perfect. I think that makes a lot of sense. So I'll come to you, Amit, because I think we had a conversation. You see, again, on a similar thought chain, I think you see mobile marketing as very mainstream. And again, the brand that you come from is so diversified in terms of the SKU or the product offering or the kind of industries that you are trying to tap in. Because we've seen, I think, from durable wearables, essentially, you know, that has come in from Cisco to obviously the push for more intelligent lighting back in the home also. So how do you see mobile playing a role for you, specifically in a case where I think the market, like you know, some of the other marketers for you, is so pan-India. You're so, you know, multi-tier, essentially, geographical locations that you target across. So how does the mobile strategy for marketing comes into the play, and how do you take the brand storytelling to the platform for Cisco?
So I think, as you rightly said, I think, you know, we have all understood the importance of mobile marketing or digital marketing as a marketer way back, I guess. But as Pawan said, you know, it took some time for our counterparts within the organization to accept that fact. And thanks to the situation that we are in right now, finally, people have agreed that, you know, we have to shift the entire conversation from footfalls to fingerfalls now. And that's where, you know, the exciting time has again started for us as a brand. Pawan spoke about as to how consumer behavior has changed. I can give you an example, right? I mean, like my own father, he's somebody who never believed in digital, you know, way of life, actually. But one day he called me and he said, Amit, can you help me how to use Google Pay? I said, what happened? He's like, no, when I go out for my regular grocery shopping and all, people, you know, don't accept cash anymore. They're like, a Google Pay kar. I said, no, this is what I was telling you about, right? So this is a small example as to how consumer today has accepted few things, at least De Rai Durustai types is the thing that I can talk about. Now, as far as mobile is concerned, I think the best part with us as a brand is that, you know, we use mobile not only for marketing reasons, but thankfully for even our product integration as well. I mean, like, you know, so you spoke about intelligent lights, right? Now, these are the lights which are actually controlled because of your apps, because of your voice assistants, etc. We have in fact launched a smart watch last month, and you know that is again controlled by an app actually. So I think for us it's a dual advantage that not only for marketing but also for product we use this device beautifully. And as far as your last bit of the question is concerned as to how we, you know, go out and tell the story of the brand, I think it's very simple. See, I mean, like we as a brand, you know, I mean, like at a brand level, we are in love with television. I mean, like, you know, so first thing that we think of is, okay, how do we go out and reach out to the, you know, millions and millions of, you know, of our customers through television. But that's one part of it. Second is, okay, I have spoken something which was very brand led, but I have to transform that conversation into something that is maybe, you know, more easy to understand as to how your products are going to help me, right? And that's the space exactly where we actually go and tell them how to save electricity, how to groom your own self with the help of my grooming appliances. You know, we are talking about contactless era today. I mean, like right from contactless shopping, payment, delivery, why not contactless lighting as well? So I think these are some of these interesting aspects of the entire brand and product portfolio that I have, which makes the journey, you know, super awesome.
Nice. So if I take it away from all three of you, essentially, one thing that COVID has helped is transformation in the boardroom, right? That's where it has supercharged the whole piece. And I think, Pawan, we'll get back to that, you know, you launching a mobile first campaign, because knowing Future Group, a very traditional house, I think it's completely new what we're hearing. So I think after World Shorts Day, this is going to be something I would be looking forward to, right? But so I come to platforms, right? Because we have some very interesting mix. I'll give a very quick understanding, right? Bobble is known for, you know, in the conversational space, essentially, they've created a niche, you know, and Ankit is well recognized in that space. So that's something that we'd come to. Spotify, I really don't need to explain anything, Arjun. I'm assuming all of our viewers would know Spotify well. But yes, I think what our own past interactions has been, where Spotify is trying to create amazing amount of storytelling, you know, going back into the campaigns, whether audio, whether video, essentially all, right? And then, Manuel, I think we will speak to you, because where Manuel comes into the picture is where we had this discussion where he gave me a brilliant point. He's saying, you know what, a lot of marketers spend money to acquire customers. Our job is to retain. And that, you know, essentially makes a lot of sense in the longer run, right? So I would actually skip the first part in terms of the question of the mobile strategy. But if we could start, Arjun, if you could help us understand that the telling of that effective brand story onto the platform, right? What is your opinion? Because, I mean, you would be one of the advocates for the same. So how do you look at it?
Sure. I think, thanks for that, Nitesh. And, you know, I was just hearing Pawan and Darshana and Amit talk about mobile, and when I was thinking about this session, I was like, okay, do we really need to talk about mobile in India? It's 2020, you know, but maybe I come from a different world. So I'm already a convert in many ways, right? See, the way we look at it, and again, picking up from some of the key things that I picked up from what Darshana said or Pawan said, two lenses to it, right? One is obviously with COVID, you know, digital and mobile was anyway accelerating. COVID has accelerated that a lot. The second thing that has happened is your routines are now new, right? They're not the same anymore. So if you look at a traditional way in which media would approach or an advertiser would approach media, you have your print in the morning, then you have your commute time. So you're probably looking at outdoor or radio, then, you know, some snackable social media time during work and so on, right? Now, everybody has their own routine. Everybody's figuring out their own sort of rhythm in terms of how they want to approach the day and their lives. And what mobile for me really drives as a part of that is context, right? It gives you context. It gives you sort of additional information to make your message more meaningful, more relevant at that point in time, right? I would say that, you know, you have with Facebook or Instagram or Spotify or any of these platforms, you have thousands of options for targeting, right? But how is a brand really leveraging that targeting to make their messaging more meaningful at that point in time is what really counts, right? So to give you an example from the audio world, which is where I come from, you know, there are, I would say, probably two or three things. One is, sure, a digital platform or mobile will tell you that, okay, this is a, you know, female, 25, lives in Mumbai, uses an iPhone, is interested in fitness, right? So that much you know because of data that you're collecting, etc. But audio can tell you, yeah, but this person is going for a run right now, right? Because they're listening to a high BPM running playlist at so-and-so time. We know that during this time is when they actually go for a run. So you have that context. So if you know that somebody is a fitness enthusiast and then you can combine it with the information that, okay, and right now they're running, what will your brand message be at that point in time, right? So it is about identifying those moments within that consumer's sort of journey through the day. And using the power that mobile and context gives you to be relevant at all those points in time, because the old sort of ways of planning your media, et cetera, don't make any sense anymore. And I think even when all of this is over, a lot of it is not going to come back because these behaviors will sort of stay, right? That is one. The second thing is we work a lot with like Spotify is an oasis for millennials and Gen Zs, right? Over 70% of our audience is skews in that generation. The other thing we are seeing, again, which has been accelerated as a result of COVID, is this whole feeling of too much visual simulation, right? Which is, I need to take a break. So if you look at things like screen time, which Apple has launched, right? Where you can control how much time you're actually looking at specific apps. There is a very conscious effort to say or think about their own consumption and to sort of cut away from that and get a moment to yourself in terms of how you're consuming, whether you're listening to a podcast, whether you listen to music, right? So it's what we call screenless moments. And I think that is something else that especially for younger generations is becoming extremely more prevalent. So brands need to start thinking about all these moments when the mobile is there, but the screen is not necessarily to your advantage, right? You can't use that screen because the person is plugged in and cooking, right? What is the point of your video ad at that point in time, right? So I think context, relevance, that moment, and customizing the vast amount of information that you get about your consumers to drive a very relevant message is what we see. And, you know, massive amounts of time spent already across mediums. So really a massive opportunity that brands need to tap into as these behaviors sort of solidify.
So Arjun, that's audio, right? Also, one of the things that we wanted to delve into, so I think, I believe Arjun and Ankit would be well slated to kind of take this up, essentially is what you have seen with new Apple ad blocking. Google is also going to introduce sandboxing, essentially cookies is going to be a problem. Right. And overall, on the mobile advertising platform, or the mobile as a platform, the advertising, there has something of a banner blindness that has started coming in. Right. And I mean, both of you actually are on certain side of the spectrum, kind of trying to work around it or provide solutions to the marketers around it. Right. So how do you see that going in the future, and possibly how could marketers from the brand's end, with the help of the platforms like yours or others, could improve the user experience, right? I mean, when I surf or I go through the web, essentially, I am so blind to the banners despite being a marketer, right? I skip them so quickly. Do I go back and look because I want to just know what someone is doing, right? But coming from the platform of audio, and then we'll move to Ankit, to you, where, you know, conversational commerce, essentially, because that's your whole mantra, that we would want to create a better UX, essentially, right? So how you guys see it? Arjun, if you could start off.
Sure. Yeah, I think there are three spheres here. From advertisers, you want more responsibility, right? You want more responsibility. You want more cognizance and awareness of what that consumer experience you want to create is. I'll give you an example. Open any news website on your phone, right? You are probably six clicks away from reading the headline because it's just it's so crowded, right? And that UX, the way and it's not just a fault of the news publisher. It is also the brands that want to do that kind of stuff, right? And that's not going to work for a lot more. So both publishers and advertisers need to take responsibility to create better experiences. You know, we, again, coming back to the studies that we do on Gen Z's and millennials, there is a very high expectation ki, you know, you have all this data about me, what, do better, right? Show me something more meaningful, right? Sure. Don't just keep doing this stuff all over again, because this is like adapting what used to work in the days when web was only desktop to a new environment completely, right? So I think that is one. So more understanding of the consumer experience, more respect for the consumer's time, like Pawan mentioned, decisions are made in an instant. If you're not being respectful of their time and the experience they have, you're not going to sort of get any value out of it, right? That is one. Two is about optimizing, like I said, so while I may have spoken about audio, it is really about what is the moment that the consumer is in. So right now, if he's looking at the screen, I have an opportunity to show video, let me show video. But later the person is not looking at the screen, is listening to a podcast, is plugged in, spending a lot of time, let me do audio, right? Or maybe at a different time I do a banner. So it is about understanding the consumer journey and being as seamless and as personalized and customized as possible, right? The spray and pray days are over pretty much.
Sure,
and specifically on mobile.
So Ankit, what's your opinion? Because I think you have a platform that goes into users' mobile phone through a keyboard, essentially, right? The most native integration that we could think of a platform. And then from there, brands could come in, and obviously GIFs or stickers is something that is being seen as a very important medium, essentially, onto the mobile as a platform, right? So what's your take, towards the banner blindness, or how advertising is happening on mobile, and how could you make it a better user experience?
Sure, Mithis. So let me start from the beginning to give you a better perspective. And as I see, after listening to Darshna, Pawan and Amit, I don't think we need to convince anyone that mobile marketing is important.
Right.
But what I would like to convince you or draw your attention towards is conversations. Yesterday, I was reading an article written by Google team. They mentioned that 50%, more than 50% of time that people spent on their smartphone is on conversations. Can you believe that? And I'm sure you would buy a phone because you want to converse. That's the primary function of the phone. right? And we believe as Popular AI, we believe that a conversation does what no other medium does. It delivers hearts and minds. It is the number one way friends talk, share feelings, and leave each other's mind changed. If I share some more numbers, specifically talking about India, 70 billion plus messages are sent every day, 10 billion plus emojis are sent every day, and 700 million plus stickers and GIFs are shared across chatting applications daily, right? And it's very interesting, and it was an insightful discovery for us to realize that many of these conversations are already having brands into those conversations. So brands are already present in billions of such conversations happening each second. Imagine yourself telling a friend, let's go to Starbucks in the evening, or talking to a friend and saying, why don't you bring a crate of Kingfisher tonight? Things like those. So people are already talking, while they're talking, they are using brands in their conversations. We picked this insight and built the entire conversation media marketing platform, which is driven by the truth, depth, and influence. In fact, I would like to take a point by Pawan here, since he mentioned about celebrity endorsement. We saw that there is a huge gap in what in the way people used to perceive celebrity endorsement 10 years ago, and today what the new generation, how they perceive celebrity endorsement, or for that matter any sort of influencer marketing. I doubt whether the person who is showcasing that product, whether they are the real users of the product. But imagine my brother or my father or my school friend talking to me and using a product in their conversation. That just adds hell lot of credibility and convincing into that endorsement. So I believe that is why this one-to-one intimate conversations becomes very important for brands to enter into. In fact, in terms of reach and resonance, I think Amit was talking about, I touched upon it a little bit. In terms of reach, conversation media like WhatsApp or Snapchat or Instagram Direct or all of those conversation media have already surpassed social media in terms of reach 5 years ago. It's not today. Right. In 2015, by the with the number of users and the time spent and engagement, conversation media have already surpassed social media. Yet we are talking about Facebook Live, and where my younger cousin is not even active. I mean, they don't have an account on Facebook. It's a dying platform. We don't believe that any of these social media we don't see them growing with that speed the way conversation media is growing. In fact, 92% of the consumers, this is out of a research by Nielsen, 92% of the consumers trust word of mouth from friends and family over any form of advertising. And since you mentioned, Mithil, that you talked about how can along with the advertising in smartphone while brands are reaching out to their ideal customers. I think this is a great way to do that by natively integrating yourself into the usual flow that people are going through on their phone. So with that thought, I would like to leave the audience. There are many more points I actually wanted to touch. I was listening to Darshana, for example, about reaching out to the right consumers at the right time. And I believe having data intelligence, the power of mobile or the smartphone comes from the data that it brings on the table, right? Real-time understanding of what the user wants. It's not static profiling anymore. It's dynamic, it's real-time. I might be a frequent traveler, but I don't need to buy a flight ticket tomorrow. Why is Truecaller still showing me a Make My Trip ad? I don't need to, right? For that matter, I might not be a foodie in general, but I'm hungry right now. I haven't taken my lunch because I was busy, and I want to order a food right now. So why am I not getting the offer from Swiggy, which I used to get every day earlier? So this is something that smartphone and the data and intelligence that comes with the smartphone solves, right? When you add value to the life of consumer, they won't be irritated by you reaching out to them. But when you start enforcing, pushing your product, I think Darshna talked about it, push versus pull, when you start pushing your product or services or brand and enforcing it to the consumers, then it becomes irritating.
So right? I think what you're saying is any which ways, what is more important at the end of the day to use, harness the power of mobile marketing and working with platforms and partners essentially is through either collection of data or through AI and ML, essentially drive out insights and then deliver back onto those insights, right? You have to get all the data into a central repository and then have to start making sense from there. And that could not be done by a platform. I think at the end of the day, a brand also has to have its own understanding of where my data is coming in and where is it going, right? So I believe on that point, because we are on the point of the data and user experience and creative storytelling, right? Manuel, I think I'll come to you because I've got the customer once to my website or into my fold of my universe in one or the other way, right? But to extract maximum lifetime value from that customer and making sure that, you know, I'm spending least amount of dollar while getting maximum back, that retention, how have you seen, you know, the tactics or analytics or analysis, what does it say in terms of retention? And how would you use the data that, you know, comes in through your platform that is taken back by the marketers, and how do they use it essentially?
Sure, Smitesh. So good to see some of the conversations, right? I mean, COVID has actually not only made some of the verticals to emerge, verticals like in edtech or gaming or media streaming apps, but I'm happy to see even the legacy business actually embracing digital transformation per se, and, you know, considering mobile or digital to be one of their core front end to reach out to their audience. Now, you know, one of the things that we see is obviously what we solve for is retention. However, we also do a bit of a behavioral analytics and insights and thereby engaging with their customers as well. Now, if you look at retention to be the goal, you know, some of the interesting benchmark studies that we have seen done shows that the leaky bucket is so huge. If I can put into perspective, the first week retention of food apps or food tech app is 78%, which means there's only 22% retention, which means 78% of the users churn in the first week. So which means it is so important and critical, if you don't put the right messaging at the right point in time to the right set of users, you're going to lose them. And it is 75% with mobile payment apps, and it's almost 55% for, you know, streaming platforms, right? So it is so important, is not just acquiring users, while you invest so much of money in acquiring those users, it is so important that you retain them to ensure that your LTV is, you know, taken care. So our emphasis is not just, hey, you know little bit of your users, what do they do? But as marketeers, make sense of that data, right? Understand where they are dropping off, at which level they're at, what position, at what point they're dropping off, and you can automate some messaging, right? Let's say, for example, if you are an e-commerce app and a user is added to cart, and within 4 minutes, which is the typical time that any user in that web buy or app buy, is not, this guy is not making a purchase, you can automate messaging, right? So what we've done at Clever Tablets is not just, you know, forms of messaging. This is something that you spoke to about, Arjun, as well. There are 13 channels of engagement that CleverTap offers you to integrate, right? Which is inside mobile and outside as well, which means you can also retarget them on Facebook and Google as well. So as marketers today, it's not just about reading the behavior of your users, deriving insights, but also actioning it at real time, you know, on a real time, that helps you to solve retention.
Right. So fair enough. I think what I will jump onto this, and this would be a question for Amit, Pavan and Darshna, essentially it's coming in from the, on the Q&A box from the audience. And interesting, because I think we spoke about this, was that, I'll quote out here, storytelling needs creativity, right? Obviously, mobile is something which is supercharging that whole need, right? So the mobile needs new content every hour at the end of the day. So have you expanded your team to kind of create this whole new gamut of content, or you go out and outsource this new requirement, or something that I would like to add to is, how have you been able to actually tailor make content towards mobile and then take it to the next level essentially? So I think between three of you, whoever wants to take this up.
Oh, well, at least I will speak on some things that do we see, if Mitesh, earlier I would say that yes, I do have a digital marketing team and they're looking at various kind of new age, stuff and storytelling, because like everybody's talking the power in storytelling, relevance of the content. So imagine, so we come from the world of 30 second TVCs to now coming down to 10 second thumb stoppers, what Facebook did last year. And thumb as a movement, and you had to adapt to that, create your story in that 10 second, create your brand relevance. So this is what we have to go through. We have to think through. But at the same time, what COVID has taught us, that it's not just about digital marketing team, at least for me, the relevance is that everybody in my team has to now think digital, because that's where your consumer is moving and the screen in the hand is mobile. So digital marketing is not anymore. A digital mindset is what has become very important, because that's where your consumer is. And that's where we've expanded the role of the team. So it's not about adding more people. It's everybody in my team has to become more digital in their thinking. That's how you have to think of your customers. And the storytelling today, I mean, there are many formats that has come up. Like Pavan spoke about the importance of 3 seconds, and 6 seconds was there with YouTube pre-rolls, and then you have 10 second thumb stoppers. Everything is getting in seconds now. And imagine you have to say everything in that. So I feel it is becoming, it is not easy to do something like that. So it is a power of both that, yes, the team has to think digital. The team has to be sharp enough to give what they want to talk. At the same time, you need a good partner. You need a good creative agency who can put this, into your video, into your whatever your story is together. And yes, advocacy, because you need real people, like Ankit was talking about. It's not just putting about, influencers, but what your consumers, what are they feeling and what are they experiencing when you get them to talk, when you create testimonials, when you create advocacy. That power is much more, and I have realized the power of that in COVID much more than pre-COVID. Today, people want real people. They don't want to be endorsed. They don't want to hear from, fake people. They want realism out there. So that would be my take, Mitesh.
Right. Perfect. So I think, Pavan, you have something to say on this, Pavan or Amit, or we can move to the next one. I think Pavan.
So I just want to add to what Darshana said. So I completely agree to the whole real people aspect, because I think digital is, in the world of mobile, right? I think relatability is a very, very important part, right? I mean, this is not a place where you create larger than life aura. It's all about relatability. I think that really works. Just to expand to the point of the, a big change within the team, as you asked, I think number one is, I think it's a mindset change. Also, as far as me and my team, we are concerned, we're all about moment marketing. So huge amount of freedom to the team. And therefore, you learn a lot from the team as well, right? So gone are the days where you have, all the high-fly cameras capturing your content. No, I mean, your mobile phone can capture the content. That's what we believe in. We create by the move. We literally take our consumers through the journey of what we are creating. That's extremely important. So I think a big mind shift change in that sense, right? And a huge amount of freedom to the team. So again, in our case, at least there is with the agency partners, I think there is one team. I mean, literally, it's not really about some brief going out, something coming in. I think those things are all sort of blurred, right? It's really about creating on the moment. If you're not able to create that, which means that you're not making your brand come alive on the world of digital. I mean, that's what we believe in.
Sure. Amit, you want to add anything to this?
I'll just add to what Darshana and Pavan mentioned. I think I think we should take a huge amount of pressure about as to how, we are going to dish out so much of content, in terms of volume. I think that's not what, we sort of chase. I guess what is important is Are you able to, you know, create something which is maybe more relevant for the consumers and something that they can relate with more easily? Pawan spoke about those, you know, flashy content. I think I agree to what he said. Gone are the days. It's more realistic now. That's one. Secondly, I think as a brand, we try to, you know, come out in the market as a small stimuli to the users, wherein in fact they help us in creating content for the brand. I mean, like, you know, because we are, you know, giving them a reason to participate in the storytelling. It is not like a one-way conversation that, oh, come and hear what I have to talk about. No, that's not the point. The point is, okay, I'm giving you a conversation platform, start talking, start creating and start participating. So I think that actually takes away this whole load of creating content, I think. So that's what, thankfully, you know, I'm not having any such target of creating so many, you know, films or short format storytelling, etc., etc. That's not my KRA.
Fair enough. So I'll actually pick up another question that is just coming from the audience first, and then because it somewhere relates back to the question I wanted to ask you all. So Amrit Mohan here asks us that, hi, my question is, how's the customer's behavior changing in last mile rural customer on mobile, right? So the behavior change essentially in the last mile rural geography that we're talking about. Definitely there have been an uptake in the mobile usage, but wanted to understand if the content there is more about the conversation, or do they prefer more visual content essentially coming to us versus the urban space where the conversation has become more prominent, like Ankit essentially mentioned. And, you know, how do you see social media versus mobile? So I think I'll just again just put it through. One is the consumer behavior change and the last mile on the rural, right? I would also want to hear, Darshna, on this from you, because the product itself is so different. I know Pawan could go out and sell his product and Amit could go out and sell his product anywhere in the country, right? But then again, the product you have essentially is needed by everyone at the end of the day, right? So the last mile change that we have seen. Second is, I think, you know, Ankit, you could also chip in there. Essentially for us would be, is rural versus urban, is it conversation or a lot of graphic content that is coming out here? So yeah, Darshna, if you could just shed some light on that last mile piece first.
Yes, it's an interesting question. Rural is something, you know, I mean, and there's a market here. Digital used to be all these, you know, top 10 cities and English and all of that, because look at the way the content has gone. But yes, today rural is very, very important. They, of course, have the phone penetration, usage, internet. What I'm definitely seeing the difference that what we have to do in a rural strategy is, one is the language by itself. The regional language vis-a-vis, you know, your content can't be, so the regionalization of the language and voice. Conversation, right. That is what I am seeing, is more and more conversation. So it's more voice, more chat, where, and you will see them that it's not that whether they can read and write, but they can talk. So even when they do WhatsApp conversations with us, it is voice. So we see more and more, you know, voice conversations coming from there. Yes, it is more and more visual that you have to give them, and in the language that they understand. Whilst they are using UPI wallets, they are using Google, Paytm, but finally, when, and because the category like mine, which is health insurance, you have to engage in that category. You have to go, you know, whether you have to take servicing, your needs, you have to serve your needs. All this regionality, voice, and those kind of tools are helping us much more. And visual, yes, it's more visual story. So that's how I am seeing it currently.
Amit, your take essentially on the last mile change in the consumers, you know, into the rural area essentially right now.
So even we also see a huge opportunity which is coming from the, you know, the tier 2, tier 3 market. See, it's not about, you know, what language they talk about, or, you know, I mean, like, that's important, but you know, we are giving them a reason to sort of talk back with us, which is about this amazing innovative product. And if that is, you know, able to create that aspiration in their mind, I think that is where they start talking back to us. That's one. Secondly, the business model, you know, is actually riding on this huge distribution network that we have, right? And it is not technically that, you know, I will only cater to top 10 cities of the country because I see a huge money potential. That's not the idea. It's a mass brand and it needs to be available across the entire country. And that's where you have a huge distribution channel, technically, which is very, very offline in nature. But the good part is now a lot of my customers are actually not only coming from, you know, those rural areas, but they're actually coming to me on my platform also talking about, okay, can I buy this product? When this is going to be launched, there is any, sort of a deal or a benefit that I can have, you know, for it, etc. So I think that's just a reflection of as to how these guys are opening up to the potential that only, you know, maybe 2 or 3 years back, only an urban customer had, right?
Yeah,
so that's a change.
True. Right. So, Pawan, I think to you, I want to change the question a bit, mold it in terms of what I eventually wanted to ask you. Was that even as people increasingly embrace digital, right? Brick and mortar still remains first choice for a lot of people that we're talking about in terms of across the country, right? So it's crucial that the business masters both the aspects. You know, whether it's brick and mortar marketing funnel, which is evolving, or whether the digital funnel, right? So being locally relevant is the key for any brick and mortar business, essentially, right? That is important, right? So how can a brand leverage mobile's power to create value for the local customer, right? Yeah. Has there been an example in the Future Group itself, which you would want to share? And for Ankit, Manuel and Arjun, I think we would circle back to you after this, because we would want to understand from you that how have you seen signs coming from the rural and the urban customers essentially in the recent past, and how could Pan India marketing be used, mobile could be used through the platforms that you all essentially represent. Right? So Pawan, if you could start off this, sir.
So I'll try and answer this from a business side and a marketing side both. Let's first understand from the business side. Obviously, during COVID and, you know, the kind of things which were happening, people were hesitant to sort of come to the store. And I think that's one of the reason why we launched our e-commerce platform, which we never had before, as far as Big Bazaar is concerned. So obviously, I think retail is all about being local, right? If you're not being local, if you're not addressing, see what a customer needs in Chennai and what a customer needs in Bombay is very different. What a customer needs in Lower Parel and what a customer needs in Matunga is very different, right? So I think that's a very integral part of retail. So what we did when we launched our e-commerce platform, we ensure that our stores are integrated. So basically, you can go to the platform and you say that, listen, I live in Matunga, so you can shop from the inventory of Matunga, right? So what happens is that you will get all the local nuances of what the store delivers to you or what the store can deliver to you, right? So therefore, the entire inventory in the store is sort of exposed to you. That's from a business side, right? Now, as far as marketing is concerned, obviously, localization is extremely important. I think Darshana touched upon this point of saying, ki boss, I mean, if you look at it, like I personally believe that the entire digital or a mobile narrative, right? Whether you look at OTT or anything, it really comes from that rural India, like literally, right? The heartland. I mean, that's what we connect. And that's one language which connects with everybody. It's nothing about rural and urban so much. I mean, that's something which reflects India, right? I mean, essentially, you know, I think mobile has really brought that aspect for sure, right? I mean, while I think when I was raising up, we were all in the world of, let's say, Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gum kind of a era, right? Karan Johar era. But today, that's not what it is. It's about, if you look at any of the OTT player and the kind of, you know, content which they are bringing from the heartland of India, right? So I think in that sense, I think just being local, just being going back to your roots, just being far more confident in India, it all, I think mobile has played a big role. And that's reflecting on any of the content which is playing, whether it's for entertainment purposes or for marketing purposes. I mean, I think that's a must today. I mean, you have to speak from their voice. I mean, no doubt.
Interesting. So I think, Arjun, I'll come to you here, because the point that Pawan also makes, which is the voice that you have to speak. Now, audio traditionally was a platform that was one of the biggest platforms. I'm talking about radio, right? And radio, obviously, in this mobile digital world, evolved into the audio experiences that we go through, whether with Spotify, with Saavn, with Gaana, or any of the other platforms that we subscribe to, right? But how do you see that audio playing a role for the brands in the pan India or the main, you know, heartlands of India, as we said? Where is the place, and what could you offer, or what could audio as a platform offer back to the brands in that space?
Sure. So, I mean, I think I'm obviously not an expert on rural markets or consumers. So I'll take a platform view, because whatever I say on the other side maybe may not be very accurate, right? My sense is that, you know, whenever we talk about these tier one, tier two, tier three, or urban versus rural, there seems to be a sort of subliminal tendency to assume that because somebody is from tier two town, they are a tier two customer. Right? That's not necessarily true, right?
I agree.
The aspirations, the exposure that they have, the influences that they have now are so global, right? If you talk to any youngster today, just like Pawan was saying, our influences were within a certain boundary. But the influences of the youngsters today are global. There are Indians who have, like, K-pop, Korean bands have massive followings in India, right? Swedish YouTube influencer could be your hero, right? And these are not governed by geographies, right? A person in a rural area could have as much access to the same kind of content, to the same kind of influences, etc., that somebody in an urban area has. And that's something that mobile has made happen, right? So I think that's the first point. In terms of what you should do, I think I will specifically go back to the point I made earlier, which is any kind of segmentation that that used to work earlier, you know, wouldn't work anymore. You could earlier bucket people into three or four categories and say, okay, category A ke liye we'll do this, category B we'll do this. But today, those category lines are blurring, their influences are blurring, their tastes are blurring, their choices and preferences are blurring into, it could be anything from very local to very global. So going back to the point earlier saying that there is so much data available, the question is, how will you use it meaningfully, right? So let's take the example of something like a podcast, right? When I was a kid, I heard Sholay as an audio cassette tape on my 2-in-1, right? Because you couldn't go and watch the movie, but you could imagine the dialogues. Now, our podcast only something that is sort of so urban, so to say? Couldn't you do podcasts for education, for entertainment, etc., across a bunch of languages or bunch of genres for different people across the country? So I think it's about understanding the niches that work for you, understanding the signals that consumers are giving you, and treating them equally with respect based on the data that you have to create the right experiences for them, right? And that's really what counts. So whether it is extremely short form, 10-second thumb stopper or a 6-second bumper ad, whether it's a 2.5-hour podcast about how to improve yourself in life and move ahead, right? It ultimately depends on what you know about the consumer and how you can use that to create meaningful and relevant content.
Fair enough. Move to Manuel. Manuel, right? So I think, guys, we would close soon enough because we are running out of time. So our list of questions remains unanswered. Maybe we'll do it later. But coming here, Manuel, because we are on this track, I wanted to understand what could brands pick out as signals or as data which comes through the mobile as a platform to retain or expand the customers pan-India again, we are talking about. You know, it's not purely the urban view that we want to take, but pan-India, what are the signals could we track and brands could use them well for themselves?
Yeah, so I think one important piece is individualization and personalization, right? Every user on your app is so different, right? Their consumption patterns, their clickstream patterns, when they start playing, let's say, for example, Spotify, when they start playing, do they pause it? Do they complete it? How long do they take to consume a piece of content? What kind of content do they search? Is it only audio? Do they search for podcast? Do they look at the lyric? So each of them are really signals, right? I mean, these signals actually collate together to give you a better perspective of that perspective, that user. And maybe that you can bucket it or bundle it with other users who are also showing similar kind of behavior, right? So when you have that segmentation, which also Arjun spoke about, right? Segmentation is the key here, right? And these signals, you have numerous amount of signals that's coming together. The important point here, we are in the generation of right here, right now. Now, if I'm listening to a podcast and if I paused it, how would you nudge me to complete? Or if I've searched for ABC content, or if I'm looking for a content, can you give me a recommendation? I'm a big fan of Spotify recommendation, right? So how relevant can you be at that relevant point in time? Now, if you look at urban versus rural, I think, yes, there are differences, but more likely when you look at very specific apps like Spotify or let's say Netflix or an Amazon Prime, you might not find that difference from a consumption perspective. Maybe from a day perspective, time of the day, consumption perspective might be different. But overall, I think there are multiple signals that you can draw out of these users, and how you make sense and you know reach out to them on the real time is going to be really critical, Mitesh.
Makes sense. In the interest of time, we'll be faster than Ankit coming to you, right? Because we spoke about, I mean, we never planned to get our conversation towards the urban and the non-urban India, because I feel it's quite odd, because I have seen, I mean, one of the examples I'll quickly narrate, because again, being around parents, I realize it's 2 to 3 years back or 2 years back, I believe, my father started using voice search more than me, right? And that as a marketer just shook me, saying, yeah, I don't do that on Google. My dad does, right? So, I mean, but we are on this topic and it is important because there is a large population of the country that stays outside the metro. And unfortunately, at times the marketers have a bubbled view. Essentially, right? So how do you see, Ankit, you know, this whole non-urban India that we, you know, touched upon, essentially, what is the evolving communication practice in terms of conversations or image-based or any other thing, important thing that as a signal is again coming, because mobile, keyboard, you guys have, I think, the first possible native signals coming to you. You know, how should brand evaluate this and how should we go ahead, you know, if we want to be across India for the brand? Yeah.
Yes, Mitesh. In fact, our data intelligence show and clearly contrast the user behavioral differences between the urban India and the pan India. It's significant. The boundaries are not blurred. It's a clear contrast. I can give you a few examples to help understand. For example, the format that you talked about, voice, is significantly higher usage in overall India than in urban India. Our voice technology was used by 6% of the daily active users in the tier one cities, while it was used by 16% of the daily active users in the non-urban cities, non-tier one cities, pre-COVID times, which has increased to 23% during the COVID times. The usage of voice is surpassing the usage of all other formats of input on smartphone, that I can assure you of. And this is the reason why every other large tech giant is investing big on doing R&D around voice services, right? And this is going to be big, no doubt about it. We have seen this happening in China as well at the same time. The second thing that I wanted to highlight is the languages. I would say that non-urban India versus urban India is a similar difference. That is the difference between Hotstar and Netflix. While we might feel like that Netflix is something so obvious and such good UX and such good content, but it's not that obvious for non-urban India. If we look at the language penetration, it is massive. The next 300 million users that we are adding on smartphone is 100% going to be native languages. Almost 99% is going to be on the native language. We have already added 500 million users on smartphone, out of which only 150 million can understand English. So you can imagine the usage of native languages and the importance of native languages when it comes to smartphone marketing. And I believe for that region, brands have to be extremely conscious about the affinity of Indian users towards their languages. Even if I understand English, but agar aap mujhe Hindi mein bologe, to wo dil ko chuega, right? So when it comes to brand marketing, it is very important to speak in the language of your consumers. And this is where I think language related technologies makes complete sense. In fact, we were forced to, by the data intelligence that we had, we were forced to create more competing products for ourselves in native languages. Today, we have got Malayalam keyboard, we have got Bangla keyboard, we have got Marathi keyboard and Telugu keyboard, apart from Bobble Indic keyboard, which was there earlier as a flagship product. Clearly, we got forced to create niche products in specific languages is equivalent to going to a food court versus going to Oh Kolkata or Punjabi by nature, right? When you go to food court, yes, you do get Bengali food and Punjabi food there as well.
Right.
But if you really want an authentic Punjabi Bengali food, you go to the specialized restaurant. And this is why we decided to diversify our product strategy and create language specific keyboards, which has worked really, really well for us. And lastly, I would like to touch upon two more points. One is time. We see that the content being consumed by consumed in tier one cities is mostly ephemeral content, in the moment content, short form of content, like stories for that matter, Instagram stories or Snapchat stories and things like those. But when it comes to non-tier one cities, we see and it is exactly opposite to what we had anticipated. We see consumption of more large size videos and the consumption on YouTube is much higher in non-tier one cities for that matter. It came as a surprise to us, but yes, that is what our data intelligence shows. And then finally, personalization, which is consistent across the country, even in tier one or in non-tier one cities. Personalization is being preferred by everyone. I pulled out some data quickly. So 66% of the consumers are interested in purchasing personalized products, and 78% are willing to wait longer to receive personalized stuff. 90% of the marketers agree that personalizing a campaign with users' data like location, language, gender, age, etc., increase the ROI of a campaign multifold. So clearly personalization is important, and this is one, and it is validated by one of our features, which is where you take a selfie and we extract your face out of that selfie and create fun stickers, GIFs, emojis out of it, which you can customize and share it with your friends and family. 70% of our daily active users use this feature, and this is the most widely used feature in our keyboard applications. And therefore I believe personalization could be one of the key factors to reach pan India, irrespective of whether a consumer is tier one or non-tier one.
Fair enough. So I think that sheds us a lot of light in terms of how mobile is being used across the nation, essentially. So thank you for that. I think, again, as I said, there are questions that we had on our agenda, which we could not take now because we are past 5 p.m. There are also questions that audience has asked, specific ones, towards Pawan, towards Arjun, towards Darshana. Essentially, I would request everybody seeing towards Amit that whoever wants to ask these questions, I would suggest them to, I think, go on Twitter and, you could tag E4M, you could tag me, and we could have the questions possibly answered there. Right. Now, to sum it up, honestly, I would just simply want to thank all of you, because I know all of you are very busy marketers, and I'm happy that all of us were able to come here for an hour's time and talk about mobile. Though, as I said, I think our topic is left midway and we'll figure what we could do out for that. But thank you so much for your time. I would like to sign off here. If anyone else has a closing thought, you're more than welcome to take it now.
Thank you. I really like this data increasing price question. I don't know. One of you should address.
Right. I believe, if I'm not wrong, let me find the question essentially, right? What impact we might see increasing data prices, not immediately, let's say 2 to 3 years timeline. I would want Arjun also to pick this up. Manuel, if you have any information around it, saying the data prices, which India was one of the cheapest markets ever, now going back on the rise, what's the change? What's going to be there? Ankit, I think you could also help us.
As an engineer, I would say the rate with which the price of data would increase, the scientists and the engineers would make sure that you consume less data to get the same amount of content and services. So the amount of data consumption would also decrease proportionately, and therefore it should not create large impact. And if it does, then the providers of the data themselves, also the providers of the data heavy services, for that matter Jio, if they increase the data prices, their own Jio services consumption would decrease, and therefore it's a conflict of it's a contradictory thing, and they would not want to do that for sure.
Manuel, Arjun, you have any takes on the data prices?
Nothing to add there. I think that makes, I didn't think of it from a evolution of tech point of view, though I recently saw that NVIDIA has launched some AI-based video conferencing tech that is going to reduce, you know, video bandwidth by 10x yeah. or 100x or something. So tech keeps up. I think if data is something that's essential to consumers and they're getting the value out of it, then at somewhere the price will, you know, the equilibrium point will be reached. And both telcos and consumers need to get value. And that should continue to happen because tech will keep evolving.
I think if you have to see it in another lens, the reason why data was cheap because there was one giant who decided to make it as a large acquisition game. And because of that, everybody had to. But eventually today, the way we have no choice, we all want data all the time, the way we are working from home. So I think now it's a habit, and obviously so now is a time for them to increase and monetize it. But even if it increases, nothing is going to change, we're still going to consume. I don't think anything is going to change in our life because the way we are consuming data.
Please don't highlight this, huh? They'll increase the
And I think in lockdown, we've realized that data has become way more important than it was ever, right? We're 24/7 connected. And I mean, I realized I'm operating on four devices simultaneously.
Absolutely, right.
I think data has become part of essentials.
We are paying everybody, you know, we are paying to three different providers. It doesn't matter. We are anyways paying, so.
Correct, absolutely.
Now, battery just needs to keep up.
Yeah. True. I think a lot more MAH is needed. Great. So I think, as I said, we would like to close here. So thank you all for your time. And as for all the viewers, if you have any more questions and the ones we've left unanswered, please tag us back onto Twitter and we could take it from there. Right? All right, guys. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.